doesn't work for government, so I tend to speak my mind a lot in these forums. So I hope you'll forgive me for the stronger candor in the presentation on our growth prospects. I'm not as sophisticated as the previous panel had suggested. I'm also an economist, but I'm in the political economy section. I have a lot of images in my presentation. I'll spare you the governance and institutions chapter. And last night I was thinking, why don't I just talk about the elephants in the room and just basically put that out there. Probably a little more exciting than my governance and institutions chapter in the forthcoming book. There is a little section on dynasties also, as you might expect from me. So the marching orders for this panel is to basically talk about political developments and how those issues might affect the growth momentum. So it strikes map into political economy, which is really what I do research on. So before I begin, let me just give you a rough illustration of what we're really ambitioning towards. And I think this is a nice sort of way to also put into context what we want, right? So this is a 2050 growth projections, and this is tongue-in-cheek, very illustrative projection. It's just real GDP of the Philippines and three neighbors, basically Thailand, Malaysia, and Korea. And if the other neighbors actually get stuck in a middle-income country trap, which is the term being used now for those countries that fail to grow at more rapid rates, we're going to overtake them if we don't get stuck in the middle-income country trap. So my message is that generally, it's not just a basic factor utilization, factor mobilization challenge that we're facing right now. It's really to break free from middle-income country trap. I noticed from SecRC's presentation, about 7 or 8 years, 6 to 7% growth. So we've managed the first 10 years for the most part, almost, right? So if we manage 10 years, 6 to 7%, and Malaysia really just lacks the more rapid growth that it demonstrated in the past, which is not what it's been demonstrating in recent years, we will overtake Malaysia by about 2026. If we continue on, and Thailand also does not manage to break free from the middle-income country trap and just grows at about 4%, if I see that correctly, and we continue 6 to 7% in real terms, we're going to overtake Thailand 10 years after that. And finally, and here's the picture that raises eyebrows, if we continue to grow 6 to 7% for another 10 years, which is the third decade of 6 to 7% growth, and South Korea continues to grow only at its present rate, which is probably not surprising because it's really a wealthy country already, then we'll overtake South Korea by about 2050 thereabouts. And I like to show this to young people and the young people here in this room, essentially because I want to find out whether this is really the goal for the country. And most of the young people I talk to say they don't want to overtake Malaysia. They want to be a South Korea. So I think in the order of magnitude of risk-taking and ambition for our economic policies, that's really the target, right? So it's not just poverty reduction, it's not just inequality reduction, it's really to industrialize the country. And I think put in this context, if this is the starting point, then many things sort of become clear, whether this policy is not so strong, that policy doesn't make sense, this policy is really what we should be pursuing, and so on and so forth. So if that's the goal, this is my contribution to today's panel. Political and economic risks, persistent poverty and high inequality. There's a lot of research on how persistent inequality can actually be detrimental to long-term growth. And I think one of the previous speakers already emphasized this. Even places like the IMF are now generating new research showing that it can create instability and it can actually be a detriment to growth stability. So these are sea changes in the way economists think nowadays in terms of an animal like inequality. Political noise and policy incoherence is another challenge, and I don't think it's really specific to the Duterte administration. We've had political noise and policy incoherence before. I recall one of SecRC's presentations when he was still NEDA Secretary General a few years back, and he showed that growth during this period when they were the growth in the country, growth in wages, was very pro-poor. The lowest deciles or the lowest quintiles actually had the biggest growth. But because of the failure to fix the food security policy, the rice policy in particular, that completely eroded the growth in wages. So that the overall impact, even though DTI, NEDA, other places are doing their jobs at creating pro-poor growth and pro-poor wage growth, if you fail to fix the agricultural sector, then it's going to undo the other parts, right? So that's the incoherence that is still sort of hitting us. I would argue in today's discussions that the lack of progress in rice policy and food security policy is also making the tax policies even more difficult to pass. Because otherwise, if you actually fix rice, that's a real transfer, in a way, to the poorest deciles in the country. So the tax package, I think, would have been much, much more acceptable if we actually included this narrative that we're also going to fix the food security policy of the country and lower the price of rice, which is a pro-poor sort of measure that could complement the tax policy right now. Third point is national security and conflict risks. I would be amiss as an economist not to recognize this. And really, the victory over Maute in today's in recent news is a good thing, but it raises some more questions on whether these types of terrorism risks will now be commonplace in the country. Of course, the other aspect of this which I also wanted to note is our frenemy China and how we are relating to this big neighbor, frenemy being a commonly used word right now. So we will be trading with China more extensively. China will be a force to reckon with economically and politically in the region. And yet, what is our relationship? What is our foreign policy towards this country? And how can we maintain a stable foreign policy with this country is another question. Last point is corruption in politics, and I think some of the speakers also touched on this. And right now, I think our discussion, and I guess some of the questions were leading to this, do we go with what we have on this incremental reform over the last 30 years or so after the fall of the dictator in 1986? Are we happy with the progress that we're making right now? Are we satisfied with the rate of progress? Or do we roll the dice on deeper political reforms, such as what is being proposed right now, which includes federalism? So I think maybe in that context, I'm also going to try and connect it to sort of a rising wave of populism in this country and maybe in other parts of the world because of a growing degree of impatience on some of these governance and institutional reforms. So this is the first slide, and kudos to SecRC for really forcefully emphasizing this during the last administration. 60% of GDP is concentrated in only three regions in Luzon. This is really the geospatial inequality in the country. You have to be born in the right island to actually have a good future in this country. So in a sense, the inequality starts with where you're born and what chances you have in terms of engaging the economy. And the economy is sort of a self-fulfilling, self-supporting sort of equilibrium where, okay, that's where most of human capital is, that's where most of the competitiveness is, that's where most of the middle class is, so that's where the private sector is also being crowded in. So unless we address this, I think we're going to see more structural inequality for a longer run in the country. So I understand that NEDA has actually emphasized a geographic lens also in tackling the poverty reduction sort of challenge. This is our rough calculations of real wage increases in the country using the 2005 and 2009 data sets. And what we basically see here is one, partly the wages in the top deciles are actually increasing the most, but also because the inflation, food inflation of that we are seeing as a country is also eroding the improvements in, or whatever improvements in the lower deciles. So if you're looking at least this three-year window where we do have data, it sort of paints a picture of the lack of inclusive growth in the country and the concentration of that benefit towards the upper deciles of the country. And I think a key here is, especially for decile one, if you look at that, it's not necessarily weak growth in wages as much as the problem of food inflation. So someone asked the question on war on drugs or war on the poor. Essentially, is the challenge right now in the sort of the problem, right? We're seeing after almost a year and a half of this particular policy, growing dissatisfaction as sort of revealed by some surveys. 90% want drug suspects kept alive, which is essentially what is not happening. The drug suspects are actually being killed. I talked to some of my students, former students in the Philippine National Police. If they are kept alive, actually they'll be sent into jails. And do you understand the situation in our jail system where 60 people are standing in a 4x5 room, basically taking turns to sleep? So parts of the institutional challenge are sort of locked on into this entire chain of failures in the judicial system that we need to fix. Here's another survey. 88% of Pinoys do support the war on drugs. And in fact, Ateneo, I understand one of our departments ran a survey in some of the poor communities. And the answer of the poor families is that they're happy with the war on drugs, partly because they see more policemen now that the president has actually emphasized this. So in many parts of the urban areas, you don't really see some of our security forces there to enforce the law. And that's a problem, because then my perception is that they're willing to trade off some of those rights for the presence of the police. And almost 3/4 of them admit that they think EJKs happen, the extrajudicial killings. So this is really quite a sobering sort of response to this survey, which was basically conducted recently and launched only recently as well. So more political noise. So war on drugs is actually creating a lot of noise already, and I think I don't need to belabor that point. But there's also noise on other fronts, such as an anti-foreign stance by the president in some instances, right? This is as early as September 2016. And there have already been concerns about the impact of these outbursts on investments. In October 2017, which is a year later from those early reports, there is, again, growing concern over the impact of these pronouncements on investments. This time, not just the United States, but even countries like the European Union, but also countries like Japan, that are concerned about the rule of law. Now, I enjoyed watching Prime Minister Mahathir, who visited us recently. And I think this is the guy to talk, actually, on political noise, right? If you were around during the Asian financial crisis, so if he was responsible for a little bit of political noise coming from our region, blaming the bankers and blaming different ethnic groups for the ills that befell this part of the world. But Prime Minister Mahathir actually conceded that investors could actually tune out a lot of the political noise, including his own, by his own experience. So he said this in this interview. But what they do not tune out is the weakness in the rule of law, which they're always looking for. So if the noise has to do with weakness in the rule of law, then there's something that might happen there. And he himself acknowledges that EJKs will frighten, not might frighten, will frighten investors. I think it's key here to emphasize an important point which really doesn't get mentioned in many forums, which is we're not interested in just any foreign direct investment. We're interested in certain types of foreign direct investment, particularly those we need to access technology and zoom up in terms of the value added, in terms of our basically industrialization story. So if foreign direct investments coming in are related to mining, are related to extraction, these are useful also. But if we're going to play around in the fourth industrial revolution, in AI, automation, Internet of Things, and other high value added sectors, we need those foreign direct investments that tend to put an emphasis on rule of law and institutions. So those types of investments actually put a premium on rule of law, whereas, as we know from the literature, mining and other extractive industries may not necessarily put so much emphasis on those parts of our institutional development. So there is a distinction, and I think we need to emphasize this from now on. Otherwise, we'll see foreign direct investments are increasing. In fact, there will be purchase of a big tobacco company soon. that will shoot up the foreign direct investment figure that Wong Ching was concerned about. I don't know to what extent that foreign direct investment will actually improve our competitiveness in the fourth industrial revolution, having a big tobacco company in the country. So I think those are the things that we need to keep in mind. I'm just gonna go through this fairly quickly, political noise. I will put you behind bars because you're criticizing martial law. Your own DND secretary disagreeing with you and saying this should actually be a remote possibility. It's not a good idea to have a national level martial law. The threats of a revolutionary government, which basically emerged last week, basically asking the EU to get out of the country, and essentially having the incoherence to actually state that you shouldn't listen to what I say. So I think I'm not going to belabor this point. There's a lot of noise in the environment right now, and it would be amiss not to acknowledge this. I think as professional economists and development practitioners, we should have a voice and say, this is not good for the country. And we can do without this, because the challenges are actually quite significant enough without this noise. So what are the structural challenges? So moving past the noise, security risks raised, rising or potentially rising, it may actually affect investments. In a recent report by the Global Peace Index, the Philippines was unfortunately one of the lowest ranked, beating only one country in Asia Pacific, which was North Korea. That's horrible, right? But here's the structural micro level story. If you look at a place like Marawi, so hats off to our AFP for actually ridding us of some of those terrorists in that part of our country. But if you look at the damage created by this particular siege, damage to schools, which may have an impact on long-term human development in that part of the country, damage to infrastructure, which will then sort of lead to possibly more instability if the terrorists and the rebel groups have more young people to recruit because they're disaffected and not included in the growth story that we are pursuing. So I think these are the things that we should have a longer term sort of perspective over, not just killing one or two terrorists or maybe even several hundreds of them, but looking at, are we winning the long-term war on bringing back our people who have been marginalized for so long and are so easy to recruit by these sort of rebel and extremist groups? This is another source of the risk, and I mentioned it's not just terrorism, it's actually our mixed relationship with our big neighbor. The thawed relations are something to be celebrated because China is playing a key role in the region's economy. But, and these are numbers that we generated recently, which I presented at the Chamber of Mines event, if you look at the 8 to 9 trillion pesos in infra spending based on the Build, Build, Build plan, it's about a decade or so of infrastructure buildup. And the present $6 billion dollars in steel imports that the Philippines already brings in every year, we expect about a 10-fold to 12-fold increase in steel imports from this particular country. Now just imagine one of your big neighbors having the capability to stop the export of a key input in your industrialization plan. So from a national security point of view, it's not necessarily a good idea to be too dependent on this frenemy of ours. So I think it's something to think about also in terms of our own views on capability to process some of our extracted materials. But certainly from a national security point of view, this is something to think about. It can stop the growth if for some or any reason some of these inputs fail to get to us. I would be amiss also to not point out the indicator which SecRC and Nobuhiro Fua published a few years ago on the lack of political competition in the country as measured by the growth of political dynasties. Now, this is just a rough projection of the growth. This is the actual data of the share of dynasties in the local government leadership infrastructure. But if you look at that growth path and just project it very bravely, we may actually get to 70% of the LGUs will become dynastic by 2040. Now, this is the expansion that they are now sort of demonstrating, the expansion path. Why is this a concern? Well, if this is lack of political competition, and we're choosing from a smaller and smaller group of people for our leadership, then we wonder why SecRC presented earlier that one of the biggest concerns of investors and entrepreneurs is the lack of government efficiency, the lack of government competitiveness. If the choice of our leadership is becoming smaller and less competitive. So I think this is something to be monitored, and certainly reforms that could be directed towards building a more inclusive democracy would be needed for the country, as it relates also to our economic trajectory. And why does it relate to our economic trajectory? Well, we have a published study that shows that fat dynasties, as they expand, are related with even deeper poverty, particularly in the farthest regions of the country. The farther you are from Imperial Manila, and the fatter the dynasty is, the deeper the poverty is for the provinces. And I'm sure you're all, well, some of you are nodding your heads. You don't see, you don't need an empirical regression model to sort of convince you that that's what's happening in those parts of the country already. Okay, my time's up, but there are a few more slides. Let me just show you a recent Harvard study of government's capabilities to execute policy. And this is sort of a new study by Lan Pritchett and colleagues that tracked over 140 countries on various indicators, which I will not belabor the point, basically directed at the capability of government to implement its own policy. So I'm here with my good friend Paul Hunchcroft, who says he may be a millionaire, or was it a billionaire, every time he hears a Filipino say, it's not the Philippine, it's not the policy, it's the execution of the policy. And he would get a peso or 10 pesos from every time he gets to hear this. I agree with it, because basically, in terms of this study, Harvard study that came out just very recently, the Philippines, and here just explain this graph, this is the growth rate of the capability to execute policy, negative on this left side, positive on this right side. And this is where you are, the static level of government's capability to execute. And where's the Philippines in all of this? Well, we're actually in the middle of the pack in terms of the level of capability to execute. But we're in the rapid negative range, where we're quickly losing our capability to execute policy. So again, I think this is not just a matter of capacity building. So I would like to sort of echo that message to the ambassador and other decision makers here in the room. It's not just a matter of capability building, because we've been building capability in this country for over 3 decades already since the dictator fell. The challenge is actually aligning the political sphere with success. Getting elected for good policies and good policy execution. So I think that's a sea change that needs to take place in order for us to basically gun down South Korea and go after that target. And I will end with this final slide. Sorry if I was over for a few minutes. This is, of course, our good humor sort of gets us through much of this. I saw this on Facebook and I said, maybe I'll end with this particular slide. Our political corruption is still taking place and is failing to actually demonstrate big fish being caught and being held accountable. So if you see here, for those who do not speak Tagalog or Filipino, they will run for office, they will win, they're going to steal the people's money, then they will get caught, then they will be put in jail, but they will suddenly develop health problems and be put in a hospital. Then they will be set free eventually, as you probably noticed a few months back, a few guys got set free. And then they will run again. So essentially this sort of circular situation, and I sort of beg to disagree with the comment earlier that maybe it's a risk that some of the appointees use it as a springboard for sort of getting elected. I wish actually some of our economists run for office so that we might actually see the Senate finally with some good economic sense. But we're not doing this, so we're actually not attracting some of our best and brightest in the leadership positions right now. Thank you.